I was dead serious about the title. Hear me out. Based on an anecdotal research I made on my own, 87.5% of users use this as a terminal. Yuck. Another 10.5% use this as their emulator. Meh. This brings us to 98% of users, again, based on my own super careful research. And then there's you and I, the special snowflakes, who geek out about advanced emulators. We can go to war over Western versus Ghosty, we have a Rust alternative for every existing CLI utility, and we think Bash is for boomers in a nursing home. But what about our colleagues, friends, and peers? I can say with confidence that amongst mine are some of the brightest developers I know. Yet they don't really care about the power of the terminal. It's just this box where they go run or kubectl get, not much beyond. Seeing them hit the up arrow endlessly for a forgotten command, retype the same mile-long one-liner just to find a typo, which then they're navigating to one character at a time to fix, can make me shiver just thinking about. So today we're helping them, the rest of the pack, because that's who we are, a bunch of alpha types leaders who carry the burden of saving the world from crappy terminal experience. For the longest time, I stayed away from Warp like fire. The experience I had a couple years back, having to sign in with an account just to use a terminal which had, if we're honest, a too fancy GUI for me, had threw me off. Some of these are actually not the case anymore, but we'll get there in a sec. So when Warp reached out asking whether I'm willing to give it another look, I thought there were two options. Either I'm going to have a really hard time justifying what I'm doing here, or they're not going to be happy about reaching out to me. Until it hit me. This, in my opinion, is the 98% terminal. Here's why. For those of you who have never heard of Warp, it's not your typical terminal emulator. To start, it's a product built by a company, not the usual open source project with contributors we all know. So on one hand, it's closed source, but on the other, you get a terminal ready to go. Batteries included. You get all the cool kid stuff out of the box, with an easy to customize appearance, VI mode, AI, and a few concepts you won't find in other emulators out there. But before we get there, let's install and build things from the ground up. Getting it is as easy as any other Brewcast install for macOS, and there's other Linux installations for real hackers out there. That's it. Launch it and witness the difference right away. The prompt is glued to the bottom, and don't worry, this is configurable. It gives us a default nice prompt that times commands and functions like your typical shell other than that. Now, naturally, my new shell isn't supported here, as the hint above suggests, so we've fallen back to ZSH, but Bash and Fish are also supported, which again covers the vast majority of users. Now for the important bits, the hotkeys. Command and slash will pop the hotkey side menu with a search bar for your convenience, which is a much welcomed option. Command and comma pops the settings, like many other applications, where you can configure everything from appearance to secret masking and, yes, logging into your account, which thankfully was waived off just recently, so that's no longer a requirement to use Warp. The last hotkey, and probably the one you'd use most throughout, is the command palette that opens up with cmd and p. This is where you fuzzy search for basically anything, from sessions through splits to workflows, notebooks, and all the goodies we're covering today. Warp also comes with its own command completion, which also carries the first complaint I have for it. If I run AWS CLI and hit tab expecting for completion, I'm getting this beautiful menu. All options laid out with a small tooltip helper with further explanations. But let's go with EC2, hit tab again, and that's kinda it. It doesn't go any deeper. Now, I'm pretty sure I didn't miss anything. My ZSH had always been able to use the full auto-completion that comes with the CLI, and this is the first time I'm not getting it. For those of you who saw my new shell video above, if you didn't, I went and installed Carapace that enhanced the auto-completion game even further, and this is what it looks like in new shell, completing subcommands, flags, and everything else. So, I could be missing something here, and even if not, I know it's a power user nitpicking, but I need to show it. That said, the beautiful tooltips and the descriptions in it can be a game changer for most users who aren't familiar with every bit of the CLI, and that's something I hadn't been able to see yet. Kinda competing with the recursive auto-completion head to head. We talked about appearance, right? So Warp comes with a bunch of backgrounds. Obviously, you can use your own, and it looks great, but here's another nitpicky thing. This is something the 2% users would say. What about a config file where I can save these configurations, Warp? It's not a deal breaker, but it's something I look for in an emulator. But hey, this is not about me, so let's carry on. Remember the prompt? The one users worked so hard to set with P1000, Starship, and Oh My ZSH? Well, Warp heard that and productized it completely. Use the command palette, pop the prompt editor, and easily pick your prompt components. Use a pre-built layout or make it your own, zero mess. But again, not very persistent. Once my prompt is set, here's all the bells and whistles out of the box. A cool prompt with the path, git status, branch, and the other stuff most Oh My ZSH users love so much. Needless to say, you can add your favorite prompt, but having it built in saves users from the nightmare of the default terminal, which is just embarrassing, if we're honest. I'm not joking. Actually, one of my videos started with this story of a meeting I joined with a startup CTO and founder showing off their new Kubernetes product by launching three default white macOS terminals on screen. I immediately lost 15% respect for the dude. I mean, at least make yourself interested when trying to sell to hipster engineers. Anyway, probably me and my issues. As with many other modern terminals, Warp comes with a multiplexer, meaning you can split and separate working environments without having to launch multiple windows. Using the command palette, I can do just that. Splitting horizontally or vertically can be done via the menu, but real power users do it with key bindings. Warp does that with Command D and Command Shift D, and yeah, the menu is missing text because of the font size. I found a bug, team. So let's split it once and then again. The focused pane is marked with a small arrow and moving around is done with Command, Option, and the arrows. As with any other multiplexer, running different commands and leaving the pane is no different. So if Tmux ain't your thing, Warp has everything you need as far as splits go. However, here's something you're not going to see elsewhere. Check this out. I can cat the README, but I can also view it in Warp. Yes, Warp ships with its own markdown parser. How thoughtful is that? Here's something I wish my terminal had. Now, yeah, sure, I can use Tmux to split a pane, then run glow, read the markdown, but come on, it's not as pretty as this one to start, and secondly, it requires a bunch of more keystrokes. Are you also thinking of a new Tmux plugin like I am? Anyway, I wanted to see if I can push this a little further and check out updates in real time. And while the code has changed, the preview didn't. But hit the three dots above, refresh it, and there's our change. A bug or a feature? I don't know, but what I do know is that there isn't a hotkey for that Warp, so please give us hotkeys for everything. All the other usuals work here, like FZF for changing Kubernetes context, getting resources and other daily tasks. But what if I want to run something else, not in a split, but completely separated? Warp has sessions for that, or as most of us call them, tabs. The cool thing about them is that Warp keeps the running command for you and can fuzzy search it using the command palette. So if I just run kubectl get pods, and my other window holds nvim readme markdown, typing a part of any of these will take me straight to the other tab. Sorry, session that holds them. This is also something I had a hard time with personally, but most users won't. Tabs are not what I call sessions, especially as a Tmux user. Sessions are completely separated, and tabs, or windows in Tmux, are part of the same session and function as another method of splitting your screen. It's subtle, it's not important to most, and I guess that Warp, being a product for the masses, made their decision based on that. Okay, now we're talking. Vim key bindings. You know how to sweet talk me into a terminal if you have a dedicated page for that. Jokes aside, this is Warp's way of letting you know they have an inline VI mode. It's a bit different than what you may be used to, but if we're honest, every shell comes with its own unique VI mode and quirks. The important bit, it's there. Can I use JJ to switch from normal mode? No, but then again, new shell won't let us do that either, so no one is perfect. Warp's VI mode has registers and cool bindings for almost all your needs, I'll give it that. Any shell that brings VI mode to the masses deserves to be praised. Now, here's another feature I want my colleagues to have. Warp comes with workflows. You may be thinking it's just fancy aliases, which it is, but for a good reason. If you have a long command, and here's a request for Warp's product team, let us just pop something from the history here, you can save it as a workflow. Add arguments and even share it with your team. Workflows are available to you in your fuzzy search box, so just look for bits of the command or name that you gave it and get it injected inline. That's it, it's running. Here's yet another cool feature I really wish my shell had. Warp puts everything in blocks, so if the command I just ran failed, and you can see it did with a reasonable error, it's wrapped by a block, colored in orange. A block can be used multiple ways. One of them is simply asking the AI of the editor what went wrong. how simple but yet genius this feature is. Instead of Stack Overflowing it, you have the thing right there. So, dear AI, what's up here? It suggested two options, running the command with the right flag and AWS configure, which I don't really need here. However, if I hit the default enter, I just get the response in text into my shell. Not exactly what I hoped for. And yeah, I can copy paste, but come on. Now, I do believe TMX would have saved the day here, but I'm not going there just yet. Since we're already speaking of AI, let's explore this further. Warp comes with agent mode, essentially letting you speak to your terminal in natural language instead of remembering commands and copy-pasting from Stack Overflow, or, well, ChatGPT. So I can ask it to print the README file of this project, which it asked to confirm the existing of, and I mean, your terminal, you should be able to do that, but whatever. Then it found it, so cat README, and that's it. Now, obviously, that's an oversimplistic example, but you get the idea. Now, by the way, Warp is also content aware, so URLs, IPs, and other things are parsed and can be opened straight from the terminal. Let's hit TMUXinator, for example, which takes us directly to the link. I'm used to TMUX's URL plugin to do exactly that. Speaking of TMUXinator, here's one configuration you can set persistent with Warp, and that is what they call session management, which is basically the option to preset what tabs and splits you want and also resurrect them from crash. If you're thinking of TMUX Resurrect here, well, great minds think alike. Okay, enough mumble, let's talk about important stuff. Command history. What about that? Well, Warp comes with its own persistent fuzzy search of history commands. Beautifully presented and very easy to use. I personally use Atuin, as some of you may know, video above for more on that, and Atuin came into my workflow after years of using purely FZF for that, which is a foundation for every great tool ever made. More on FZF in the video up here. Warp does its thing by productizing the essentials and bringing it to the user, again, out of the box. So I've mentioned TMUX like 100 times in this video as a reference, how about just firing it up inside Warp? Now it does everything you'd expect it, and it does it flawlessly. I'm missing some nerd font and icons here and there, but all in all, and in my personal opinion, this is the way to work everywhere. But we're dealing with the 98% of users, right? They don't care about TMUX, and even if they did, they're not willing to climb the learning curve. Warp splits their screen, that's good enough. Okay, back to minor issues I had, like scaling the font up to a point where the emulator seems to block you from moving over, so I had to manually resize it using the settings. Worked like charm, but the next time I hit command plus or minus, I'd be thrown back into the range that's allowed. Kind of annoying for us content creators or boomers in nursing homes who can't see the font. What about performance? Glad you asked. Let's hit Warp's AI with it. Command I pops agent mode, and let's ask it to monitor the resource consumption of Warp and the alternative. Yet again, not a great answer, but luckily I can do it myself. But here's something strange I had to find out the hard way. I couldn't find Warp's process anywhere. It was just hidden. I mean, I know for a fact it's running, but where is it? Well, popping the application file structure inside contents and macOS, Warp's binary, for whatever reason, is named stable. I mean, I understand the reason, it's just not the best place to make the release naming for those of you who are looking for the running process. With that mystery solved, htop of stable works, and we can see Warp's resource management. Compared to Ghosty, it's a little bit more intense, but to be fair, I'm not running a proper comparable test. That said, I was happy to see that Warp are actually taking performance pretty seriously. There's a documentation page with performance comparisons for iTerm, Alacrity, and even WESTerm, benchmarking all kinds of parameters from cell density through Unicode parsing, and the numbers are really not bad. If you keep browsing the docs, you're going to find more and more surprises, like secret masking and others, but the coolest thing I found was their Docker extension. What this does is letting you inject Warp into a running container with your prompt, your settings, and everything. Check it out. I'll run an Ubuntu with an interactive shell, and now by default, it looks just as bad as any other shell on any container. But Warp has this Warpify option where you hit that and boom, we're in. Same container, 10x shell experience. It even comes with AI, so I can keep using natural language from within the container without copy-pasting anything. It does have its edges though. A split won't split itself within the container, like for example having TMUX inside it, but other than that, pretty impressive, including the fuzzy command history searcher and everything you want. Not bad. Everything up to this point gives me this feeling. Like I said earlier, Warp should be the 98% terminal. You get sessions, multiplexing, AI embedded, easy configuration for long commands, and history management, everything you want your colleagues to have. Am I going to use it as my daily driver? No, but that doesn't mean anything. When it comes to the terminal configuration, I get extremely nerdy, which makes me a nerd by definition. Anyway, try it out, some stuff are genius and requires further thinking on maybe they should be imported to our snowflakey setup. If you're not settled on Warp though and want to go the 2% nerdy path or want your peers to do that, here's my complete setup from scratch with batteries included. Thank you for watching and I'll see you on the next one.